So they protected the land reforms which were required to be carried out in India. Then came the Seventh Amendment, most significant reform with regard to the boundaries of the state, territories of India. So boundaries were of the states were, now they were defined on the linguistic basis. Prior to that, English people had given the boundaries in a different manner. So now the government of India brought in the boundaries on the basis of linguistic basis. Then the third, which I would propose, is 42nd Amendment, which was enacted during emergency. And I think most of you must be very much aware about it, 42nd Amendment. So this was also called Constitution of Indira or Mini Constitution. So it is due to this amendment that Indian Constitution became socialist, secular and democratic republic. Fundamental duties were also introduced in this amendment. But apart from that, there were several difficulties created by the government of the day. The powers of Supreme Court were curtailed with regard to dealing with certain matters. The emergency provisions, the fundamental rights were suspended of the people, and they could not approach for judicial review of the decision taken by the parliament. That is how the power of Supreme Court was curtailed. Power under Article 32, power under Article 226 were curtailed during this amendment. And this amendment was upheld also by Constitution Bench of Supreme Court, if you all know. And there was only one dissenting judge. Can anybody name that dissenting judge? Yes. So Justice H.R. Khanna was the name. So out of the government control, that time the Supreme Court was functioning in a particular way that the government had total control over, as it seems from the history, means I was not present, I was not even born during that period of time. So Justice H.R. Khanna had defined himself, he had evolved himself to understand the true meaning of our constitution. So Justice Khanna defended this aspect of human life, that you cannot take away the liberty provided under the constitution, and liberty would contain the very right to move before the court if your right is violated. So if a person has been arrested, you cannot take away that right that you cannot go before the court. So prior to that, the different definition of emergencies were differently provided, but Indira Gandhi had given that even if any kind of rebellion is there, then they would be put in jails under emergencies, which was changed by Janata Dal government, ki only armed rebellion should be there, otherwise it should not be there, so people should be protected. So there were various things, government of the day, I don't know what were the difficulty faced by the people then and the government. But yeah, Justice H.R. Khanna, one bright silver lining that we had that time, we even see today, like in Aadhaar judgment, which I will come on later. Justice Chandrachud had descended in a particular manner. And if you will read those lines which he has written, it is a remarkable piece of dissent that he has produced. So, 42nd Amendment, there were so many things. Means I will not go into the nitty-gritties of those things because I assume that you are already aware of those things, so I am just taking you through on the historical background. Then came the 44th Amendment, which tried to overhaul those changes created by 42nd Amendment and brought back certain powers to the Supreme Court, which were taken away by 42nd Amendment, in which Justice Khanna had a dissenting judgment, and then rights of property were deleted as constituted as fundamental rights, and they were made as a constitutional right under Article 308. And there were various other things which was done by way of 44th Amendment. So then came 52nd Amendment. It came in 1985. The anti-defection law were introduced. Anti-defection, you must all be very much aware about what is anti-defection. a political, this is essentially a political party feature, means somebody had contested election on a particular party ticket, and after contesting the election or winning the election, then in the parliamentary proceeding or state assembly proceedings, if they do not comply with the writ issued by the party or do not vote in favor of the party as per party's agenda, then in that case that means the anti-defection law can come into effect. There are various events defined under that section, but the big point to be understood is if somebody wants to defect to its parent party and join the other party, so there is a specific number of majority which is required. If you are below that, then your candidature, your party ticket, everything is suspended. So what was the reason that it was brought in? So people, the media had termed it as horse trading. If I would have been in media, I would have termed it as ass trading. So you are not trustworthy. You are just playing politics on the basis of money which is being provided. It is not. It is a trust deficit. So horse is a good animal.